So next on stage is Sebastian talking about his singer as a service. And it's your stage. Thank you and welcome.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm looking pretty forward to have some beer afterwards, but I think now it's my turn now, and I'm going to talk about iSinger as a service for today. So I want to share and show you what we are doing with iSinger on our NetWays web services platform, and because I think we are running iSinger not in the most common way, and that's what I want to show and describe to you. So this talk is split up into three pieces. I want to give you a short introduction to the NetWays web services, and then I want to explain our iSinger as a service product itself, and in the end I want to have a deep dive with you into a technical architecture, what we are using and how we are running iSinger 2 or all the products on top of the architecture. But first up, let me introduce myself to you. My name is Sebastian Seemann. I'm working as head of managed services for the managed service department right now. So I'm responsible for four teams right now. And we're doing mainly data center stuff. So hosting, managed services, and all those things. And yeah, basically I'm a systems engineer. And if you like nonsense, you can find me on Twitter as well. Yeah, that's all about me. NetWays. I'm working for NetWays. I think most of you already know the company. You should know. Almost the whole speakers are my colleagues. And I just want to add one thing to remember. And I think NetWays does have great people there. So we are awesome team. And if you think you are awesome too, perhaps you might think about applying to us because we are hiring. And yeah, perhaps we find some new colleagues here. Okay. Nowadays, everything can be a service. So there is function as a service, there is container as a service, and there are the popular ones like infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. And I just want to clarify and explain the differences between the most popular ones. So the main difference, like you can see, is the layer of responsibility. So on which layer the service provider is responsible for the underlying technology. So let's say you want to run your iSinger 2 on your own or in your own data center, you are responsible for the complete stack. So even air condition, power, network storage, and so on. So if your iSinger 2 is not working properly, it might be the network, it might be the operating system, it might be some libraries, what else? You can get rid of that and choose one of the most popular infrastructure as a service provider like AWS, Microsoft Azure, or Google Cloud, and then they are responsible for the data center stuff. So they keep they take care about the networking up to the virtualization layer. And you are still responsible for the operating system itself within the virtual machine. If you only want to ship some software, you can go to a platform as a service like Heroku, for instance. They will provide you some frameworks like Ruby on Rails or environments for Ruby on Rails or PHP environment to just ship your software there. And they are hosting it and you are only responsible for your data and your application. And yeah, last but not least, the software as a service stack is responsible for all the layers, so even your data. So that means the customer data, which you are uploading, for example, are getting backupped, the applications are getting upgraded and updated, even the runtime and so on, so the complete stack. So what is NWS, or NetWays Web Services? NetWays Web Services is a software as a service platform. Hosting popular open source applications. We launched yesterday, 1 year ago, so we had the first birthday of our platform yesterday, and you can find some tools or some applications like GitLab, RocketChat, Nextcloud, SuiteCM, and of course the iSinger 2 applications. And because this is an iSinger camp, I will only talk about iSinger, of course. We have two products. So one of the products is the iSinger 2 Master. It is a pre-configured stack, and it comes with Tom's Director, what he was explaining to you right now, and Grafana and Graphite for all the metrics. There are plenty of plugins already installed and pre-configured. And a text message gateway, so for SMS, to notify your service manager on duty, for instance. And we have a good agent integration. I will come to that later. You can benefit from the solution if you don't want to fiddle around. I guess everybody is pretty much able to do this on his own. I think at least better than me, because I don't have so much clue about iSinger 2. But you don't have to fiddle around. You don't have to take care about backing up data, taking care of the availability, or doing updates. So it might be that you have a project or a special department where you need a monitoring solution based on iSinger 2, but you don't want to integrate it in your already existing monitoring environment. So this can be handy for you then. One of our customers, he's using the iSinger 2 Master with the agent integration like that. I think it was a question already in Tom's session. He creates a new virtual machine, and our scripts, so our agent integration scripts, are already deployed within the AMI image, so within AWS, sorry. And those scripts then install iSinger 2 agent on top of the virtual machine and set up the SSL certificate stuff which iSinger 2 needs. And then it will communicate with the iSinger 2 master. And after that, it also, this was also a question of Tom, or to Tom, it configures itself through the Director API inside of the monitoring. So that means your newly created VM is then already going to be monitored by iSinger, so it just appears. The second product we have is the iSinger 2 Satellite. The iSinger 2 Satellite is basically an extension to your already existing iSinger 2 setup. So that means if you have iSinger 2 installation already running in your data center, you can extend it by using our iSinger 2 Satellite. And this satellite can run on multiple locations. So we have locations based in California, in Europe, so in our data center in Nuremberg, and we have it on in Asia, Tokyo. And with that, you can have a different perspective of your reachability from a different location. That means you can measure latency to your web services or something else. If you don't need that, perhaps you need it because of the monitoring of the monitoring. If your iSinger cluster or iSinger instance is not working anymore, I think no one will notify you. And the satellite is able to send some text messages or send you some emails if your iSinger 2 setup is not working anymore. Okay, I want to show you how those products feel and how they look like within our platform. So that's pretty much the back end of the NetWays web services. You can reach us at nwsnetways.de, so you can register there and start some applications. And I already started iSinger 2 and the iSinger 2 Satellite already. And if you click on the iSinger 2 Master, this is pretty much what you get. So it's a basic iSinger 2 installation with the extensions. We have some we have Tom's Director inside of it, so you can configure all your services and hosts by using the iSinger Director. Also, we have the Graphite module and stuff like that. So it's all already working, and you just spin it up, and it's already configured. So that's the main plus. Of course, you can use it in an own tab if you like to. But what is really handy for me is if you just move over to the next part. So on top of that, you have a Grafana web interface where all your metrics, which is iSinger is collecting, you can have a look inside of the dashboard. So And like I said, you don't have to fiddle around with all the technologies. The other part is the Azinga 2 satellite. It's a little bit different because it does not have a web interface. It does only have an documentation or explanation how you set it up and to get it running. And it only needs two steps. So you have to configure your master and you have to configure your satellite. So this is the master part. You only have to do a copy and paste inside of your configuration of Azinga with the snippet. And then you have to edit the Azinga 2 satellite. Here you can choose or fill up the form. You choose the location where the satellite should be running. You set up your master endpoint, so the host name of your Azinga 2 installation. And last but not least, you only have to decide which way you have to go, which you want to go to sign your certificates. So you can either use the Azinga 2 PKI functionality of Azinga itself. This is only working if your Azinga 2 master is reachable from the internet. And the other way around would be a manual signing of your SSL certificates. So this is also documented here. And you put on safe and that's it. And everything else then is configured within Azinga 2 on your data center or in your data center. In your configuration, so this is only a zone which is added to the to your Azinga setup. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Docker. So. Every app of every customer, so if you decide to spin up such a service from us, every app of every customer is a standalone instance. And we are running those instances on a shared platform. But we want, of course, to isolate all the processes, the storage, and the networking, so that no other process can talk to a different container on a different network. And for that, we are using Docker and to isolate all the apps. Why we use Docker? Because 1.5 years ago, it was the best technology with the greatest feature set for advanced networking and for advanced storage. But nowadays, I would perhaps choose something different. I would choose, I think, the Mesos containerizer, but perhaps you have a little bit or different problems then. Because the Docker daemon can be a pain. But for now, it's working quite good. As an example, the Azinga 2 master, or the Azinga 2 master app in our case, is made out of those five core services. It is MariaDB for the IDO, it's Graphite and Grafana for the metrics, and it's the Azinga web interface and Azinga 2, of course. And all those core services are containerized, so everything is a single container. And those containers then are grouped as a complete application. Within our cluster. Yeah. And if you decide to start one of our apps, you will start five containers on our platform. That's the way it works right now. One of those containers is not only a container, so it's a smart container. And because there is some scripting and some coding within, and those containers are taking care of of the specific settings. So you have seen the configuration tabs of the Azinga 2 satellite. And all those settings you can do within our web front end, they are getting generated and configured within the container. Also, they are preceding data if the container starts for the first time and create some things like services, the plugins, and all the service definitions in an empty container, of course. And yeah, if we're upgrading Azinga 2, they are also running database migration. So if the database schema was altered, they are also taking care about this. And of course, they're taking care about not deleting your data. Yes, so all containers are running basically on this stack. We have Ubuntu as a operating system underneath. We thought about using CoreOS. for that because we are only using containers. But in the end, we are using a lot of Puppet, and that's why we decided to go with Ubuntu. On top of Ubuntu, we have a Mesos cluster. I will explain this cluster just in a second. Just a quick question. How many of you know the Mesos or Apache Mesos project? Three, is that right? okay, I will give my, or I'll try my very best to explain how it works. Okay, yes, I've never, or I, no, okay. I didn't expect that, to be honest. Yeah, so we have a Mesos cluster on top of Ubuntu installed. And on top of that, we have frameworks like Kronos and Marathon. So Kronos is a distributed cron job manager. So like the cron tab on a local Ubuntu or local Unix system, it is distributed on a cluster. And Marathon, as the name would suggest, is a framework which keeps your apps running. So if one container is failing or crashing, the framework takes care about it and starts it somewhere else. This is a typical Mesos architecture. So you have, or it consists out of the master, or the Mesos master itself. So usually you take at least three because of high availability reasons, so for quorum and failover. And you have the Mesos slave, so in the blue box, there are slaves. This can be hardware, this can be virtual machines. You need at least one, but you can have 1,000. So you can scale by adding more slaves. So this or those slaves are the workhorses. They are executing your tasks in the end. Every slave then needs a task executor. So for us, we have a container executor on top of it to execute Docker containers in the end. And then on top of that, you are running, or you can run Marathon, Kronos, and other frameworks. There are plenty of them. They are talking to the complete architecture underneath. And the Zookeeper cluster over there, so the purple spots, you need it for for the key value or as a key value data store, where Mesos and Marathon put some state information into it. So when you want to start a task, a Mesos slave reports all the resources it has to the Mesos master. So for instance, it says, I have 10 gigs of RAM and 10 CPUs for free as a resource offer. This resource offer then will be sent to the Marathon framework or to another framework like Kronos. And the Marathon framework then can decide on its own logic or own constraints if those resources are good enough. And when those resources are good enough, it sends it back to the Mesos master and the task will be getting scheduled on top of the slaves. Yes. And as I said, the Marathon and the Mesos master, of course, have to put their state information into the key value store, Zookeeper. Yes. I don't know if you have already questioned yourself about those questions, if you don't know Mesos, or perhaps you, all of you, I think, know Kubernetes. It's pretty much the same, you can say so. And on those cluster or container architecture, you have a lot of problems, I would say so. So the main questions or main challenges are how to deal with container interconnection, how to deal with data persistency, and how to deal with service discovery. First one fall asleep, I guess. container interconnection. Container interconnection means one container should be able to talk to another one on a different host. So one container is starting on, slave 1, the other one on slave 15, and they have to talk to each other by either their IP address or by their DNS name. But of course, they are isolated in a group and should not be able to speak to a different group. So you want to split up the network traffic. So you can see those two containers there. They're running on two different nodes. They want to speak to each other. You can assign them IP addresses. So the IP address 111 /24 wants to speak with the two. And this all is done by using the Docker Overlay Network. And this Docker Overlay Network then is using Virtual Extensible LAN, so the VXLAN technology. I don't know, who have heard of VXLAN already? Okay, that's a lot more people, that's good. You can think of a VLAN, which is on layer 3, so if that makes sense. So it's an industry standard like the VLAN itself, but it's across broadcast domains. So you can, yeah, you have a VLAN, a layer 2 network, on top of a layer 3 network. And this is working like that. You have VTEPs, those are virtual extensible endpoints or endpoints of the VXLAN. And this is routable within your data center, so this is just a normal IP address. And if one container wants to speak to the other one, they send just a usual layer 2 frame. And this layer 2 frame will then be tagged by using an VNI, so VXLAN ID. And this will then encapsulate it in a UDP packet and transport it by the IP packet itself. So this is pretty cool, and that's the solution for grouping network in our case. Data persistency. This means to keep important data in case of a node failure. So you have containers running on top of slaves, and it can happen that this slave is crashing, and then you don't want to lose your data because Marathon would try to migrate a container somewhere else. And for this, we're using a Ceph cluster. So Ceph is a distributed storage, and we are mapping RBDs to our slaves or to the containers itself. That means, yeah, you can compare it with, how's it called, iSCSI. iSCSI loons, so we have a block device, and this block device is just cycling around with the container. So if the container is getting migrated to another host, the block device will follow. Yes. If someone is using Docker and has a Ceph cluster, we are using this one, if this can be interested to you. Yes. Last but not least, the service discovery part. Service discovery means how to route and forward traffic to the containers, because if you're starting containers in such an environment, they are getting spawned on random ports on random nodes. And for this, we are using HAProxy in combination with Marathon LB. Marathon LB is a Python app, and this Python app is connecting to the Marathon framework, to the API, and it's collecting all the state information of this framework. And so it consumes the state and generates an HAProxy configuration out of it. And HAProxy is, for our case, it's pretty beneficial because it can forward traffic of all cases or of all styles, so not only HTTP or HTTPS, like other solutions like, I don't know, VulkanD or GoGetter, or some load balancers like that. It can also forward the 5665 or 6 port of iSINGA 2 itself. Sorry for that. Okay, so in the end, we have a complete setup. We have dealt with the container interconnection stuff. We have persistent storage, and we have a service discovery part, which is, yeah, like I said, finding my containers on the different nodes. The cool thing is that we can scale this architecture horizontally. That means if we need more computing power, we just add more slaves to it. And if we need more volume in terms of block storage, we add more Ceph storage or more Ceph nodes to it. And I think this might be or can be pretty overwhelming, perhaps. Because there are a lot of parts and a lot of moving parts inside of that. But in the end, it's pretty simple to use. It has good APIs. And if you want to start an application or a task, so a container in our case, you can just send an HTTP post to the Marathon API. So this is a RESTful API. You send a JSON hash to it. Everybody who knows Docker should be see the differences, not the differences, the similarities. and you send it to the API, and the API then talks to Marathon, and Marathon is starting your container. And how this works, I also want to show you in a quick demonstration. Yeah, so this is the Marathon web interface. I have here a demo context folder, and I will then start per API. I have prepared a JSON hash already, so I will start here my demo my app. I give it some memory, some CPU, and basically it's a Docker container. So it's an Nginx which shall start there. And yes, for the service discovery, I also say it should be reachable under myapp.nws.netways.de. So as soon as I send it, I hope this works. I have a deployment, so it tries to start a container now. And as you can see, it starts on NetMeso slave 7 on a random port right now. So right now it's in the status staged. I think it's now doing a Docker pull of the image. And now it's healthy. So as soon as it's getting healthy, so this is a basic TCP check, which is checking the application on port 80 right now, the load balancer will kick in and will load balance or forward the traffic to this host. Yes. So if I go on myapp.nws.netways.de, I should see, this is the document root, so it's remounting the uname or the etc host name of it, so it's running on a NetMeso slave 7 right now. And if I need to scale it, because I have a lot of, load on my web server, I can scale it either through the API, or I can just scale it up to, to 6 instances. And then Marathon will start another 5 containers. So those containers are in staged or healthy mode. And like I said, as soon as they are getting healthy, they will be integrated into the load balancer. So this takes, just a couple of seconds. And now, as you can see, it's not only slave 7, it's slave 8, it's slave 4, slave 6, and so on. And all are running on different ports on top of the slave, so on top of the system itself. And if I go now and type the reload button, you can see the load balancer is just spreading the load across the container. So, for instance, if this is your Isinga web interface and it needs to be load balanced, it's pretty or fairly easy to do that. Yes. And of course, I will clean up my mess and send a delete to the API. And everything is gone. So that's pretty cool, I guess. Yes. What you have seen is the health check within the Marathon. So the Marathon takes care about checking the TCP port 80 of the container or of the random port to reach it. And for our case, we need more monitoring to make us and our customers happy. So we want to check what you usually check with Isinga. You want to check a string of a website, or you want to log in and stuff like that. And for this, we're using also Isinga. And we are happy as soon as the state of Isinga turns green. And we are doing this, like Tom was also explaining to you, by using the module, the Isinga web module, called Marathon module of Achim. And this is a pretty dynamic director import source. So this connects to the Marathon API. So it basically works like the Marathon LB, the load balancer stuff. And it consumes and gets all the apps that are running within our cluster. And then it generates, with the help of director and the modifier rules there, or sync rules, the corresponding checks. And on the right side, you can see in the activity log how those services are getting generated and deleted. And yeah, for us it's very important because our system, we don't have no influence in it, because our customers are just, I don't know, spinning up and deleting applications, and our monitoring is reconfiguring it by itself. This is pretty cool, I think. And for this solution, so we have an Isinger 2 installation already, but we don't want it to mix it up. So this Isinger 2 installation, which is doing those automatic stuff, is basically a NWS application. So we are, in the end, a customer of our own, and using our own Docker containers over the platform to use monitoring for the rest of our application. If that makes sense. Yes, I hope so. What we try to do next is that we are developing more apps, even more sophisticated ones. Right now we are working hard on infrastructure service parts with some software-defined networking, but this is a complete different story. And what we are really interested in is getting your feedback. So if you want to try our products and have some ideas or something, some things that are missing, please tell us. We are trying to evolve and try to make our products better. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Thank you for listening. And if you have questions, feel free to ask them now. Or yeah, just grab me while I'm here.
Any questions?
You surely said that you had issues, I think, with Kubernetes. So what are the reasons? Or yeah. Did you even test if it works with Kubernetes? Or why did you choose Mesos to use?
Yes. We choose Mesos or Mesos and Marathon over Kubernetes because 1.5 years ago it was just a complete different story. Right now I think Kubernetes is the major major competitor in the container wars, I would say so. And but Mesos is not pretty much different, so it's just not so hyped. It has all the same features and perhaps a little bit more, because like I was trying to explain, you have the Mesos cluster underneath, and on top you have the frameworks, and those frameworks are not only running containers. You can run, I don't know, Ruby scripts, Java, jars, you can run Spark applications, so you can run something different and use your resources in a different way, so not only containers. And the idea was to sometimes use something different on top of this architecture as well, but we are not there yet.
Okay, thanks. More questions? Okay, over there.
What is if the Mesos master will be crashed?
The Marathon master?
Yeah, the middle of all the system.
Yes, if the Marathon master would crash, so we have three of them, but if all three, or if you just turn it on, nothing happens. So the HA proxy has already its generated configuration. The only thing, so it can still forward the traffic to the containers. The only thing what is not happening is to, I don't know, recover failed containers or start new containers. So it's just a broken service, but no broken production.
Okay. More questions? Okay, then I would say again, thank you, Sebastian, for the talk. Thank you.
Thank you.